Hello and welcome to National Herald. I have a very special guest with me today, Devashish Makhija, and this is his book. Excuse me for this, these yellow marks here, they're mine. And this is a book we are going to discuss today. To begin with, let me just introduce you to my guest. Although most people, I just presume that most people will know you, but I guess I should. So Devashish is, for those who don't know him, which is a rare possibility though, he's a filmmaker. He is the filmmaker who has recently made Bhosle. He's made Ajji before this. He's also assisted in films like Bunty or Bubbly, Black Friday. And he is also a writer. He's written some beautiful short stories. I have been privileged enough to read some of them. And now you're going to talk about his novel. Devashish, is this your first novel by any chance? And it's beautifully written. It's beautifully written. And it's it reminded me of many things. Also because I have been on a similar journey as a journalist. To some of these places. I am going to read out something that Devashish has written here. The jungle sounds are broken by a distant patter. Thup, 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 it comes. For me, that is Oonga. It's extremely tribal in its sound, in the way you have written it. I could practically smell things and see things. And it's written in beautiful English, which is a rare combination, I must say. when you are so close to the soil and you can write something like this. What made you actually write this book, Devashish? Did you go to Orissa in search of a book, or did you go to meet people and then found your book? What was the journey?
Back then, I went in 2010, and in the few years leading up to 2010, I had written a few films for myself to make at some point, or a film called Bhumi, to be more specific, that got shot. In fact, 90% of it was shot, and then it got shelved, and nothing came of it. So I wrote those films. I wrote Bhumi with, I did months of research, went through almost 4,000 pages of material. But I'm almost fortunate, I think, that the film didn't get completed or didn't get released, because I was not proud of what I felt was an incomplete voice. So in 2010, with no other agenda, I just traveled. I just went with a journalist called Javed Iqbal and a documentary filmmaker called Faizal Khan, who made this film called Stupen of Malega. So she was traveling with Javed, and Javed, and at that time, Aman Sethi and journalists like them, they often took along somebody from civil society, anybody who wanted to go understand a different perspective from the grassroots. And I found that very, very progressive of them, because they even when I used to sit and ask them questions, they're like, you know what, just come with us. At most, we can tell you what we think, but if you want to understand it for yourself, see it through your own eyes, come with us. We anyways travel, we have a beat where we cover a story for the New Indian Express or whatever it is that Javed was writing for back then. So I traveled those areas with no particular agenda other than wanting to understand the perspective that I was not getting sitting in the city. And in just 5 weeks, it came back, I think, with so much inside me that I've been generating stories and material around that ever since. And Oonga was I didn't know I would write a film called Oonga or a story called Oonga, or all the things that I proceeded to write, including some of my short stories in my book, Getting. But all of that, I was carrying it so it would find some channel. And Oonga became that one vessel that carried a lot of what I came back with. So it also took many years to find its form.
While I was going through your book, there were a couple of things that kind of reminded me of some things that I had seen as a journalist, but I couldn't have written it this beautifully. There is this, on page 20, you mentioned, Padua is gone. Every hut, every hut has disappeared. Even the trees stand alone and afraid. Their roots don't touch one another anymore, says Ungama, fear trickling into her voice. Did you actually go to some of these villages? I am aware that there are these villages where something that urban people will not be able to even imagine, that there are these dead villages now in some of these areas. What was your experience of these places?
So I can't say that any of these episodes have an exact mirror in what I saw, but obviously it's an amalgamation of many things. One or two things that I saw or experienced sort of stayed with me. There was one Dongriya Kong village where, and so a lot of the tribes that are closer to the city have over time given up their, you know, their tribal dress and the tribal way of living, and they're wearing shirts and pants and all of that. It's not like there's some other people. They're human beings who are living in India, so there's some cross-pollination between their culture and our culture. In the villages that border the smaller towns or the non-Adivasi villages. But there was this one area, with this one village that was actually very actively fighting Vedanta. Vedanta was trying to make inroads in a particular area, and there was one village where the... So it was about 18 kilometers in, 18 kilometers of a walk and taking a boat across a river and going up a hill and going down a hill. No roads led there. So it took us almost a day to get to that village. So at some point, so we had a polis or a, you know, like a Tata Sumo or something that at some point met us somewhere and took us a certain distance, and from thereafter we walked. When we reached that village, most of the people who were taking decisions in that village, the leaders of the village, were women. It was a true matriarchal world. And when they saw us in shirts and pants, and I was wearing woodland shoes because we had to walk through the forest, they saw that as the archetype of the CRPF. You know, those kind of clothes and those kind of shoes are what the CRPF wear. And they heard that we came part of the way in a car. So they put two and two together and assumed that we are representative spokespersons of the same world that the company came from. And the minute we reached there, so I don't speak Puri, so I didn't know what they were talking about. But one of our friends, a local Amarish Satpati, he was actually being our translator and traveling with us. So he overheard two women talking, saying that let them come in, we'll kill them. They won't leave alive. So Amarish didn't tell us that. We went in, and once we were in, and we sat down, we started talking to them, and I could sense anger, I could sense fury, I could sense a disinclination to talk to us. Then Amarish leaned in and said, okay, they're planning to kill us. Don't get alarmed. Let me handle this. He said, they're planning to kill us. How are you going to handle that? So we need to talk to them, tell them that we don't have the same agenda as the other people from the city who must have come here. So suddenly that moment became unreal for me. It almost became like a moment in a film that I might have imagined, but I didn't know that a moment like this could be real. And it only took one very simple small thing that Amarish did. So when they took rice, the starch water is something that they drink. So it's apparently high in protein and good for the system. So Amarish just told them, I'm hungry. So they said, but what will you eat? We don't have anything that you eat. He said, whatever you are eating. He said, we only have some starch water left. He said, give it to me. So he took starch water in their vessel and he drank it, and they just calmed down. He said, oh, he's drinking what we drink. So he can't have come to hurt us. And within a second, the discourse changed.
Mm-hmm. So tell me, Devashish, what is that one thing that you felt you learned about them, which you couldn't have learned if you were just sitting in the city? Because there are those experiences, right? When you suddenly realize that, oh, this is what it meant. You may be a well-wisher of the tribals. You may know that, you know, there is definitely another perspective here, more than what the mainstream media is reporting. And in spite of that, there are these ah moments when you go there. What were your moments?
But when I made that journey, I realized that we are no different from the tribal. We are all human. And somewhere our origins were in the heart of nature as well. We've just over 2,000, 3,000 years of civilization, we have moved further and further away from nature. So what I learned, I think, or what I realized, my biggest epiphany there was, coming back from there, was that the Adivasis, not the other. They have just chosen to not walk down that path of urbanization, of consumerism, of cementing our homes and using plastic and metal and distancing ourselves more and more from nature. They've just chosen to not walk that path. But if some of them choose to walk that path, they will end up where we are. So it's not that they are in harmony with nature and we are not. Every baby that is born in this world is probably born in harmony with nature. And then as we grow up to adults, we just move further and further away from nature.
So talking about hopelessness, there is this moment in your book where almost a kagaz nahi dikhayenge kind of a moment where interestingly, the tribals are saying that we don't want to show papers. And this time, of course, the papers are being asked by the company and not the central government. Did that come up quite often? And was that suddenly also stuck somewhere? Because, I mean, living our urban life, we don't even think that some you know, most people in this country actually don't have papers. That is the truth. How did you conceive the scene? Was it something that came through conversations, or was it something that you saw and you thought that you don't?
So when we were there, you know, there were there always are some praja lawyers who will be fighting maybe 1,000 cases, you know, without taking compensation, because those Adivasis don't have anyone to represent them when their case come up for hearing, or they are incarcerated for no reason, and they keep getting shunted from jail to jail. So if you pick up in South Orissa, you will be lodged in an Andhra jail or a Chhattisgarh jail or in a Nagpur jail, so that it becomes difficult for you to fight the case where you were actually picked up and where the case actually belongs. So most of the paperwork being interstate was in English. So any time someone like me or Faiza or Javed came, you know, pass through trying to understand the situation or report on the situation, they would beg us, reel us in, saying, you are here for 3 weeks, can you help us read documents? Because there's thousands of pages and just 4 praja lawyers probably can't do that. There was one particular case where many underage under trials, like 12, 13 year old kids, were picked up for, so like one, I forget the name of the place, but a bunch of Adivasi were protesting something that the government had done, and outside a police thana. And of course, all of them were rounded up under unlawful armed assembly, because they were all carrying bows and arrows. Now, okay, unlawful armed assembly with bows and arrows itself doesn't make sense, because you don't go around picking up sardars for carrying a kirpan. So the kirpan is allowed under the constitution, but a bow and arrow on an Adivasi is not. But in that group, half of them were kids who had just come along with their fathers. And they were all thrown into jails for adults. They were not put in juvenile detention, because there were no jails in those areas for juveniles. So we were helping them read the court papers, then look for the schools inside the forest that these kids must have gone, see if there was any paperwork for attendance, any registers, that we could show that these guys were going to school a month back. So they are not 18, they're actually 12. So in the reading of those papers and, you know, going to those schools which were in the interiors of the forest, and of course nobody maintained attendance registers, so we couldn't find proof to show that they were 12 years old. So we said, let us come with you, to the lawyers, to the jailer or to the lawyer of the state, and plead the case, because we'll talk in English, maybe it'll help or whatever it is. So we went to the jailer, we went to the lawyer, and every time we tried to talk, that person would get up, walk away. That person would enter a door, shut the door in our face. That person would look right through us. That person would pretend like we are not even there. That sense of being made to feel like my identity is null and void was so powerful that then to realize that these people are going through this every day of their life, because they are living on land that they've lived on for 2,500 years. Some of those villages didn't even know that India had achieved something called independence. There was literally one village where they thought that the British were still actually making the law and they were being implemented by Indians.
This is such an important point, Devashish, of the element of not being seen. I mean, it's something that we are constantly trained in our surroundings, and of course even the tribals train themselves. I'm sure they live as a collective. They of course look at each other, they feel for each other, but when you are not seen by important people, that is a feeling which I guess most people here who come from a certain class and caste can't even imagine. So I don't want to give an impression to the people who are watching this that this is only a very serious and a very intense book, because it is not. If you see this, if you see the cover of this book, I mean, actually, when you the first thing that you see here is something like Avatar or Avatar, I would say, as Americans say it. I thought, oh, is this influenced? Is this like a joke on Avatar? What is this? So I'm sure you somewhere consciously put that color here, right? I mean, what made you do this?
So this story actually came to me from a little anecdote that I heard. Another person who was of great help and support when we were traveling through Orissa was a lady called Sharanya Nayak, who used to head ActionAid. Now, she's not an Adivasi, but she dedicated her life to the Adivasi struggle. So we went in 2010 February. This was about, I think, 6 months after Avatar released. And she had taken a bunch of her Adivasi workers, ActionAid workers, to watch Avatar. And when they were watching it right through the film, so she narrated this episode to me. She said they were screaming and clapping and crying like, this is our story. It's our story. How did these people know?
Oh, they could identify clearly. They could identify clearly.
It's our story. Mm-hmm. But by the end, it ended happily. And the people who wanted the unobtainium left and they got their forest mm-hmm. back. But our lives don't end like that. So they were really disappointed in the film. Like, it looked like it was telling our story, but that's not how our story generally ends. So somewhere, I didn't know that I'll write Oonga many years later, but somewhere I left Orissa with a personally given to myself mission that maybe I will tell that alternate story to Avatar where it will end authentically with some authenticity to the Adivasi's condition in this country. So so in the story, this little boy, he runs away from the village to go watch the Ramayana, the Ram Leela that he missed, that the other kids went for. In the original story, it was Avatar. He runs away to go watch Avatar.
Oh, but okay.
Cinema within cinema is something that doesn't excite me. Like, to show a film within a film.
Mm-hmm.
And to run out and try to get permission for Avatar, I didn't want to waste that much time and effort on that fight. So we chose to go to the source material of the Avatar, because James Cameron also, in a lot of his interviews back then, said that he borrowed a lot of tropes from the popular ideas of the Ramayana, of the color blue of Ramayana.
Yeah, I was just coming to that, you know, the color blue is also color of our Krishna and Ram, for that matter, right? Vishnu, actually.
Popular versions.
The popular version, yeah. Tell me about poetic justice. Do you see any kind of justice actually happening in the end? Do you see any hope?
I think poetic justice, also the word is an irony. Because over the last 2 years, I've stopped writing poetry. And every time I wrote poetry, and it was fueled by rage, or fueled by despair, fueled by seeking justice, I realized poetry is even heavier on irony than writing a novel, because you're only preaching to the choir. You're only sharing it with fellow poets, or people who appreciate poetry, people who appreciate the poetry in the language that you're writing it. So it's not bringing into its fold the people who actually matter, the policy makers, the people who need to be affected by what we are saying. So if you're getting poetic justice, you feel poetic justice writing a poem, it's an illusion, because you're getting that momentary release or that momentary, you know, fulfillment, but it's not really. I don't think even stories can change anything, but at least they can provoke thought. They can get you to go home and think about it. Then what you do with it is up to you. But a poem beyond the poets or the readers of poetry doesn't even provoke thought where it needs to provoke you. Because those who don't cherish or enjoy poetry won't read or listen to poetry. So I stayed away from poetry because I find it, there's a word I use, you know, like a snake that eats its own tail, Ouroboros. I find poetry in English, I'm talking about English poetry only, I find like it's eating its own tail. It's not really breaking out of that loop. So there's no currency for me in poetry classes. And I don't know what hope is, because if people are up against a modern culture, like consumerism, capitalism, urbanization, it's a culture now. It's not just greed or, you know, you're doing it for money. It's not culture. I'm born in a laptop, on a Zoom call. You take this away from me, we can't even talk beholden. Overcome a culture. So if this culture wants to wipe out your culture and, you know, envelop you whole, you can't fight it. So how can you have hope? There's very little hope to be had anymore.
There is very little hope to be had anymore. Okay. Well, that's the writer telling us, and in a way, the chronicler of our times. So, Devashish, on that extremely great note, extremely great note, thank you very much. And thank you for the book. I'm going to show the book again. Please go and read the book, because it's really not as dark as it as Devashish sounds. It is realistic, I will say. It's extremely real, and it's a story of a little boy called Unga, and there is a lot of joy in watching him, and there is and you might just feel driven to actually protect Unga.